Now, I'm sure a lot of you remember Club Penguin from your childhood, a game played by millions of kids around the world.
So as a lot of you might know, the popular kids website Club Penguin announced that they'll be shutting down on the 29th of March this year.
This was a mistake!
A lot of people are, as you may have noticed, not too happy about this, but unfortunately the people behind this don't really care.
The mobile and desktop versions of the game will be shut down in order to allow the team to focus their efforts on Club Penguin Island.
So basically, you may have heard the news that Club Penguin Island is shutting down.
Club Penguin Island had an incredibly short lifespan for an online multiplayer game.
The original Club Penguin experience no longer existed.
So where did things go wrong?
When did Club Penguin die? A simple question with a simple answer. Yes? Well, perhaps not. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to The Right Opinion, the home of a twat with too much free time. But this time isn't just any time. Once again, it's gamer time. That's right, you heard me correctly. We are going back to the gaming corner of YouTube because, as I have proven time and time again, I am a gamer. And today we are looking at an online MMO which some would argue is unrivaled in the gamer spirit that it has fostered. Now, you may have suspected an undertone of irony there, but don't be fooled, my friends, because back in the golden days when the Right Opinion was a young lad full of zest and zeal, there were three games which shaped his early online experience, those being RuneScape, Neopets, and the topic of interest today, Club Penguin. I can't remember which order I played them in exactly, though I could take an educated guess, but I still remember them fondly for being able to capture sentiments of wide-eyed wonder and imagination that seem far beyond my grasp these days. And I know this wasn't just a personal experience. I'm sure many of you reminisce to a time where such avenues felt like a genuine escape to a different world. However, as time has progressed, so have we, and such memories fade into the background of a distant past. Nonetheless, I find some consolation in the thought that if I ever wanted to attempt to emulate that escapism again, those sites are, as of right now, ready and waiting to welcome me home. Well, all except Club Penguin. Yes, Club Penguin, an abandoned abode. Their tragic demise seemed intangible to many, for a site which had once boasted over 200 million registered users and 30 million active users. However, its last few years have been plagued by drama and conflict, eventually culminating in rather cataclysmic fashion. For those who are unfamiliar, Club Penguin, sometimes abbreviated to CP, was an online game in which your character could take the form of a penguin and participate in various activities all over this online world, full of many other colourful fluffy characters controlled by very real other users. As a child, it taught you the ropes of online safety and interpersonal friendships. It had some pretty fun games too, and for the young mind, Club Penguin helped prepare individuals for what the internet was going to throw at us, which is an ever more important learning curve in today's society. Yet in spite of its supposed relevance, it no longer plays a prominent part in the online sphere, and today we'll be finding out how that happened. However, to understand its end, we do need to go back to the beginning, and maybe provide a little background for anyone who never had the privilege to roleplay online as a virtual bird, unless you're one of those avians, of course. However, I think it's time to bring in a friend. Now, if you're familiar with today's guest, you may have recently seen me pull off a legendary voice performance on one of his newest videos.
Well, booking boys.
Oh, you f***ing mug! You!
I'm gonna fuck! Take you down to Chinatown.
Normally, I charge for such convincing characterization. However, his payment was merely his undying love and this feature. Ladies and gentlemen, talking about the origins of Club Penguin, I present to you the internet historian.
Thank you. Thank you. Real applause. Thank you. Here we are at the Club Penguin. So allow me to break the ice with the story of how Club Penguin came to be one of the most successful online platforms ever. First, I need to introduce you to three men: Lane, Lance, and Dave. Lance was developing for Dave at New Horizons Productions, where Lane was hired as a sales representative. So that's how they knew each other. At this time, Lance would be working on web-based games though Lance's previous projects had included the unfinished Snow Blasters, Experimental Penguins, Penguin Chat, Penguin Football Chat, there's a bit of a trend here, and Ballistic Biscuit. One day, while Lane, Dave, and Lance were drinking some Tim Hortons and looking at the local moose,
there's animals fighting in the front lawn!
They realized that the current online market wasn't offering a safe site for kids to socialize in a fun and interactive way. And that needed to change. In the words of famous philosopher Helen Lovejoy,
"Won't somebody please think of the children?"
So when these three saw the gap in the market and realized the combined power and innovation they harnessed, they saw a business opportunity and decided to fuse their energy into one earth-shattering, world-dominating, universe-ending project known as Penguin Chat 4, soon to be known as Club Penguin. Work began in 2004, and the name was picked in 2005. They used Penguin Chat 2 as a springboard for various prototypes before reaching a satisfying product, launching the beta test on August 22nd of 2005. It went well. Very well. So well, in fact, that they had a party to trial the server capacity. Now there's an animal party. Club Penguin was originally set to release for 2010, but they thought, sod it, and dropped that bad boy in October. It launched with 15,000 users, but by March 2006 had surged to 1.4 million, before reaching 2.6 by September in the same year. Not bad. And by the two-year anniversary, Club Penguin hit 3.9 million, despite lacking a marketing budget. However, this is when the big wigs began to take notice. The Club Penguin crew had previously turned down a few offers, but then comes Disney, who represents a pretty large sum of cash, and strikes a deal with the founders who hand over Club Penguin and their parent company. Dave, Lance, and Lane stay on to work for the game, but individually leave the company over the following years to take on new personal projects. In the years following Disney's acquisition, Club Penguin continued to grow, launching multiple spin-offs, hosting sponsored events, hiring more staff, opening new servers, and setting up offices all over the world. By 2013, Club Penguin had over 200 million registered accounts, alongside a highly dedicated fandom. Quite the achievement for what was once a humble indie game conceived by three amigos, and even more impressive considering they were Canadian. Everything was going swimmingly for our frosty friends. However, that would soon change. To what exactly? You'll have to find out after we've spoken about
Stop.
Excuse me, I would like to finish the ad, please.
They're not paying me this time.
The people deserve to know.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Out.
It's about my sheer love for the game.
Out. Go. Leave. Leave. Right now. Had it with you. You and your Shadow Man bollocks. It's my turn. sorry guys, wow. Thank you, Professor Historian. I must confess, it is quite the honor to host such a distinguished academic for this prestigious esteemed topic. And as my friend has likely depicted, in its first decade, Club Penguin ascended the ranks and achieved astounding levels of success, establishing itself as a torchbearer for child-friendly online platforms. It was something worthy of celebration. However, come 2016, this was all about to change, and not in a fun way. So, without further ado, we must now look towards the downturn of Club Penguin and the factors that were instrumental in its unfortunate fate. Ladies and gentlemen, I suggest we embark on this icy endeavor. Decisions, decisions, decisions. An inevitable and somewhat necessary part of our lives. We often make decisions with mind to direct consequences. However, as the famous historical documentary Back to the Future demonstrated, certain decisions and actions yielded by them can have unforeseen long-term repercussions that may alter the course of history. When it comes to Club Penguin, we can all likely determine the approximate moment where the cracks in a seemingly solid foundation began to show. But in a way, its destiny had been set long before then, and cemented by a certain, well, acquisition. One piece of information that you might be interested to hear is that Club Penguin was solely financed by its founders. They had the full 100% share of the game, and they had retained that until 2007, when a very prestigious company entered the picture. Let's talk about Disney. Oh, Disney, Disney. Who doesn't love Disney? Well, me. And it's not that I don't love Disney because I'm not a fan of their creative output. In fact, I would be more than happy to argue that they have pioneered multiple pieces of culturally defining content, which justifies their beloved reputation. However, at the same time, I don't think a corporation's reputation should be solely shaped by their media offerings. I'm aware that makes me no fun at parties, so don't invite me to them if that's a problem for you. But the magic wore off on me a long time ago, and as the fairy dust settled, all I saw was another profit-driven shell, devoid of whatever spirit it used to possess. With that said, in spite of my own personal opinion, as a business, they likely did have a lot of resources to offer. So when they approached the Club Penguin co-creators in 2007, with a pretty hefty $350 million sum, an abundance of industry experience, and state-of-the-art infrastructure for Club Penguin's emergent company New Horizon Interactive, later renamed to Disneyland Studios Canada, it would have been hard for our founding friends to say no to them. In interviews, Club Penguin co-founder Lane Merrifield seemed rather thrilled at the time, stating that negotiations on his end had mostly focused on discussing philosophical values, something close to his heart. Now, I have no doubt that Disney adhered to these requests. They likely invested a lot in the development of the game, provided an exemplary working environment, and assisted growth over the following years. However, as you probably know, this deal wasn't initially worth $350 million. It was actually $700 million. The second $350 million was dependent on growth targets for 2009, growth targets which the team did not reach. In another article documenting this failure, it had claimed that statistics reportedly pointed towards a decline in users. And although Disney disputed this, it's a possibility that it may not have provided the buyers with the performance they were hoping for. Now, people sing their high praises for the atmosphere that Disney cultivates. However, when it comes to expenditure, I've always received the impression that Mickey Mouse over here, in spite of his friendly face, can be quite cutthroat. It recently furloughed roughly half their employees while protecting their bonuses, launching Walt Disney's great niece, Abigail Disney, into a rather savage Twitter rant. And although we can discuss their many motives, the point should be clear. They're not really into spending money on other people. However, with Disney, I feel it doesn't stop there, because many would argue that regardless of the highs and lows, Club Penguin was still generating revenue for Disney, and therefore there was no reason to bring its future into contention. But Disney doesn't operate like that. Disney is one of the fastest evolving companies out there, particularly in the entertainment industry. It's forever changing, and it won't waste time holding on to the status quo if it doesn't make them as much money as they could be elsewhere. When Club Penguin was purchased, there were three other online MMOs in operation by Disney. By 2013, they had all been shut down. Club Penguin outlasted its contemporaries impressively, and by 2015, the site still had millions of users. But it clearly was not enough. It's not just about making profit, it's about how much. And at a point, Disney came to the conclusion that it wasn't enough. The corporation had no great sentimental attachment, the original founders had ceased working with Disney years ago, and the invested resources could easily be allocated into something more fruitful, not to mention the numerous bugs on the game that would develop over such a long period of time. So in 2015, the Disney began the process of slowly diminishing the amount of support for the servers. They began laying off staff members, closing offices, and discontinuing certain versions and spin-off games. At that point, Disney had played this down, stating that they were just attempting to make the business more efficient. But over time, it seems that these efficiencies weren't enough to make the game lucrative for them. Now, cost-cutting is seldom an effective way of revitalizing a game. It may help you through a financially rough patch, but it won't renew audience interest. With this in mind, it felt like Disney was preparing to gradually usher Club Penguin from the stage that it had occupied for so long, and over the next couple years they did just that. Now, there was always unrest in the Club Penguin servers, and the narrative that Disney had ruined Club Penguin had been present for years. However, I feel like most users viewed it as a defiant cry for a bygone era, rather than a serious narrative. And at the end of the day, what can one say to it? Well, Club Penguin itself was engineered towards 6 to 14 year olds, which means you'll inevitably encounter a high turnover of users after a couple years while having to compete with numerous other MMOs and catering to a rapidly changing cultural zeitgeist. Now, Disney was no stranger to evolution, but part of that evolution is about knowing when to phase a brand out, and at some point management came to the conclusion that such time and assets could be invested elsewhere. I'll say this much, Disney didn't necessarily ruin Club Penguin, but Club Penguin infrastructure made it much harder to maintain. Disney couldn't keep up with it, nor did they have the motivation to. It's a small part of a much greater pitch to them. Their threshold for underperformance is a lot higher than most. So on January the 30th, 2017, it was announced that Club Penguin was to be closing its doors within the next 2 months. This was met with shock from many in the community, with some even starting a movement to save the site from its assumed fate. But it was all in vain, and after an extravagant last 24 hours where they lifted all restrictions and users were finally able to tip the iceberg, an integral part of Club Penguin mythos, the game which had brought so many people childhood joy gracefully bowed out. And that was the end of the story. Which is of course what I'd say if this was the end of the story. However, as I'm sure many of you are aware, this was not the end of Club Penguin. In fact, it seems that some people had other plans, Disney included. Let's talk about those plans. Now, I and many others hold the opinion that the definitive Club Penguin ended on that spring day. However, Disney themselves wouldn't agree. In fact, in their January announcement, they explained their plans to replace the original Club Penguin with a new MMO, Club Penguin Island. It was originally known as Project Super Secret and teased in the years prior while they were gearing down the original platform. However, its purpose as CP's successor didn't become apparent until Disney's declaration in early 2017. And in March, it was released, practically on the same day, to a glorious fanfare. Well, not quite. I suppose this decision may have made sense at the time to the average marketing team, who assumed that dedicated Club Penguin fans were going to flock to its successor on the basis of namesake alone. And they had designed it in a way that would make it more fashionable. It was initially exclusively available on Android and iOS, because all the pipsqueaks are on their phones these days. However, Club Penguin fans were more perceptive than Disney gave them credit for, and this overall rather cynical ploy didn't seem to wash with most users of the original game. In reviews, many called out the game's membership baiting and the lack of features for anyone unwilling to pay the $4.99 a month for the game. A hashtag was even initiated called Not My Club Penguin to allow audiences to express dissatisfaction at Disney's direction with the new app. Many also noted the multiple bugs on launch, the size of the app, and the effect the game would have on slower phones. One particularly chilling comment read, "It's no fun when you have to pay $10 a month just to wear clothes." Not entirely true, but we'll get to that later. Either way, it was the end of days for classic Club Penguin fans. In spite of the overwhelmingly negative reception and its decreed status as a cash grab, Mickey Mouse pushed on, eventually launching the game on Windows and Mac later that year with running updates and server events. As a game at that point, it didn't appear particularly egregious. You could do some stuff, it was a pretty standard mobile game on launch, but that was also the failure. Without sounding too sentimental, it had strayed from the original spirit that many users identified with the platform. Disney had been leading Club Penguin down this route since the original purchase, with their Disney film-sponsored themed events, which, although harmless, did seem to undermine its fantastical tone a little. However, with Club Penguin Island, they turned it into a mobile app first and a Club Penguin game second. If it was an addition to Club Penguin Online, I doubt people would have complained too much. As a little side thing, sure, we can make that work, even if it wasn't very good, but it was promoted as the heir to the Penguin throne, and when you have that, you have standards to live up to.
So, Axel, did you like the game?
It was good until I found out that you can only do 4 fucking things in this game.
Besides the quality of the game, Disney completely misread the room. In probably one of the most significant marketing misfires, their release was the equivalent of having a rave at a funeral. Although I'm sure many users weren't exactly grieving, they were disappointed that a game which clearly held a lot of value to many of them was no longer able to be a part of their lives with non-transferable content. And Disney coming in and offering this shoddy substitute, it was insulting. It's like breaking a priceless Ming China vase and then offering your plastic plant pot as compensation. You need to reach a point where people wouldn't be comparing the two games directly. And the fact that Disney released this when the other version was closing down, a conclusion that the game itself had hyped up makes me question how in touch they really were. You know you have failed marketing when the shutdown of one game is more important than the launch of its successor. They were worried that people would forget about it, I guess, but when you release content like this, you'll just make people want to forget about it. With that said, in spite of its troublesome launch, May did begin to report over time that the game was gradually improving, particularly following its launch on PC, with the team behind Club Penguin Island being quite connected with the fandom and their concerns. It seems there was a crew who cared a lot about the quality of the game.
This was the hand they were dealt. They were responsible for a game that was getting an incredible amount of upset, and it's no doubt their hard work was much appreciated by the people who genuinely came to love Club Penguin Island. They actively listened to criticism, and they tried to make it better. Whenever there was a bug or a problem, they did everything in their power to fix it. And despite everything, it seems the Club Penguin employees did everything they could to make those last few months the best experience possible. They did a Halloween party, a Waddle On party, they gave everyone free memberships and coins, they added an offline mode with a bunch of cool features and stuff. They wrapped up the Club Penguin Island story, they did a bunch of mod meetups in game, and even released remastered versions of the classic Club Penguin minigames, alongside leaking various projects early that they were planning for the game. And the whole time, they were talking to the fans on Twitter and answering all their questions. Even months after the shutdown, they're still talking to people on the regular.
Nonetheless, any seasoned internet historian will tell you that first impressions matter, and the damage had been done with that catastrophic launch. So in spite of attempts to keep it afloat, Club Penguin Island was a flop. And in 2018, less than 2 years after it was released, before the Puffles had even been added, like, come on, bro. Disney disbanded the remaining staff at the Club Penguin headquarters in Kelowna and discontinued the game altogether. And I mean, altogether. Yes, in their announcement, they make it pretty clear that the franchise as a whole was coming to an end, alongside reports of corporate restructuring and the dissolution of their general video game sector. In a letter that was subsequently leaked, Disney cited global competition as their justification for the rather abrupt layoffs. Competition from whom exactly? Well, as discussed earlier, there are many other popular games on the interwebs, and even games that don't necessarily share the same format, but still manage to reel in your audience. Disney were clearly dissatisfied with the performance of many of their video games and wanted to export future responsibility on that front to the ever-reliable EA, otherwise known as Excessive Avarice. Oh, sorry, I mean Electronic Arts. Freudian slip. However, even with this information, there were a few other thorns in Disney's side. You see, Disney cut costs initially with mind to this. They were completely aware that it wasn't generating the income it once was, but was still creating something worthwhile. Even if Club Penguin Island was rather mediocre, even after the backlash, surely some users would have settled on it with the knowledge that at the end of the day, it was Club Penguin. And if the developers were legitimately attentive to people's requests, then coming on board to bring about positive change may be the best response. Let's not forget, Disney had the rights. It's not like you could just clone Club Penguin and put it online yourself. I mean, who would do that? Well, what if I told you there was a way to play the original Club Penguin online with free membership for all users? You would be in disbelief, I am sure. But, my friends, you better believe it. And over the following years, these places became a popular refuge for the former Club Penguin fandom. So, let's talk about the private servers. Now, private servers exist for many games. In fact, they existed for Club Penguin Online prior to its cessation. However, as we've observed, it seems that many users weren't actually ready to waddle on. They wanted to hold on to the place where they created these memories, and that was valid. So when word began spreading about these sites, where you could do this, that, and the other, and take advantage of new benefits, which weren't even available on the original Club Penguin, then people understandably pounced at the opportunity to take advantage of that. These private servers weren't direct replicas of the then present day Disney platform, but they appeared to be implementing running updates which helped them strive towards the functional and engaging MMO.
You're a boy. Yeah. Big boy.
Big boy?
Oh my, watch this. Watch, I'm gonna make it look like a bitch, ready?
Wait. You just wiped.
No, get
ditched. Okay, I'm gonna steal your girl.
Whoa, hold on.
The alternative which received the most groundswell initially was a server by the name of Club Penguin Rewritten. This was launched a couple weeks after Disney's January announcement and sought to attract disenfranchised users from the moribund game. Now that's a fun word I should use more. It was based on early generation versions of the site, mostly from the late 2000s to the start of the 2010s. Around a month after its launch, they established an item transfer program. However, this was shut down promptly after Disney unearthed this scheme. In spite of this setback, they grew significantly throughout 2017, surpassing 100,000 members after the game's closure and 1 million members in around October. These were substantial numbers for a private server, with some creators promoting it as a worthy substitute, which was faithful to its source material. However, this wasn't the only server, and as the demand grew, the supply followed. Numerous other Club Penguin servers emerged and began running operations similar to Club Penguin Rewritten. They occupied a significant portion of the remaining Club Penguin audience, leaving many to wonder if Disney would respond. Now, Disney did have the option to issue such servers with DMCAs, and due to certain interactions, it became quite apparent that the company was aware of their existence. They filed a legal complaint in October 2017 towards Club Penguin Rewritten and their use of the domain clubpenguinrewritten.pw. However, this appeared to be resolved after the site's domain name was changed. When brought up, Club Penguin Rewritten defended their use of Disney's material as non-profit and educational. Although the educational element is covered under fair use, it would be highly debatable whether their documentation here was transformative enough, and I'd be inclined to side against it. Some also pointed towards advertisements being shown on the site, challenging the non-profit credentials, though I haven't seen any in my own examination. So why didn't Disney act? Well, if they had succeeded in pulling down these sites, I doubt it would have done them much good, as it probably would have just made users and moderators more stubborn and alienated the remaining fans that they had. So this may have held them back from being more dogged about it. But one thing was for certain, Disney was going to struggle to win back the lost audience here, and it appeared over time that these private servers had won the battle for the heart of the game and had become extremely powerful in the process. With great power comes great responsibility, and as time transpired, some began to question whether those in charge were properly equipped.
Club Penguin Rewritten was hacked and the database was breached by hackers. And do you want to know how bad of a breach it was, even though it wasn't released publicly like some other Club Penguin private servers? Club Penguin Rewritten was using a hashing method called MD5. Basically, MD5, what it does is it just like takes a password. If your password is password, it just takes passwords and it like encrypts it, even though it's not really encrypting, it's hashing, but it just jumbles up the letters and it makes a really long stretch of text. So let's say I hacked Club Penguin Rewritten a year ago. I could take anybody's password, I could dehash the MD5 hash, and I would get the text of the password plain as day. So if I wanted to hack Cody's account once I hacked the Club Penguin Rewritten database, I could just take his password, put it in a website, get the plain text, and then I'd have his password. And if he's stupid, as stupid as he seems he is online, he would use the same password on every website, and I could just hack into every single one of his accounts. And that is why Club Penguin Rewritten was not safe a year ago.
When you run a large site in which people have data which they wish to protect, you are in control of a lot of user information. When you're part of a large company, preserving user data is a relative priority that one has the resources to commit to. If you fail to do so, you may lose consumer trust, and you could well be hounded in the media for not having the sufficient protections in place. Large companies like to conduct themselves with a degree of professionalism because business is on the line. This doesn't just mean a load of protections from hackers, but it also means employee culpability if one of them goes rogue. And given the possible future employment repercussions if a person does do that, generally people like to respect the privacy of the users they are assigned to safeguard. With bootleg Club Penguin clones, these principles are predominantly a little less prevalent. This doesn't mean that people won't try to guarantee user security, but it means they may struggle for a variety of reasons. Firstly, you need a consistent and accountable workforce. Plenty of people do their work online anonymously. This is not just anonymous to the user, but this is anonymous to the people they work with as well. Club Penguin Rewritten, as many sites alike, claim to be non-profits. Some of these sites did this for legal reasons, others likely did it to compete. This meant that you had to rely on good faith volunteers, some of whom you probably didn't know that well, and could disappear at any moment. Secondly, such security relies on very advanced technical programming, which once again doesn't seem that many users behind these versions have great experience in. It doesn't mean they're incompetent, no, I'm sure they do a much better job than me, but I'm not the one they need to be worrying about. On three separate occasions between the start of 2017 and the end of 2019, Club Penguin Rewritten experienced cyber attacks, two of which resulted in millions of user data being compromised. As for the staff, well, it's hard enough to run a Discord server with a few thousand members, let alone an MMO with millions. So I don't plan to rag on the executive staff too much here. But when you present such content under the Club Penguin banner, you have to do the best. It's impossible to ignore the fact that there have been multiple incidents involving one or two staff members which has spiraled inconceivably, even leading to the website being offline for over a month. However, despite all of Club Penguin Rewritten's technical shortcomings, their management, albeit occasionally amateurish, did not seem to act with malice.
But it seems the actual reason why the private server is shutting down is because it's simply gotten too big for the people running it to handle. Apparently, it was being run by a group of teenagers who were working on it as a passion project and wanted to learn how to manage an online multiplayer game.
I feel that generally speaking, most of them did have good intentions, and if you manage to root out the agitators, then you can run a somewhat functional project. The team did seem to genuinely take an interest in improving their game and did introduce changes and events which reflected this philosophy. They were arguably the most mainstream Club Penguin server, and for what it was, they didn't necessarily do a bad job. They created a place for people who didn't want to be a part of Club Penguin Island, but still wanted to be a part of the community that they had come to know and love, because Club Penguin was always greater than the game. Club Penguin Rewritten outlived Club Penguin Island, and over the years following its launch, the game persevered. So, what happened next? Well, although Club Penguin Rewritten was a platform somewhat true to the spirit of the original, a new brand of server emerged, and one that would eventually become even more popular than that which we've just discussed. That wasn't a good thing. Let us continue, my friends. Private servers are not safe. But that's no surprise. No private server was completely safe for those who wanted to use it, because you're sharing data with the individuals in charge, and allowing it to be opened up to those who may breach that site's security. There was a point where private just became a buzzword, and the truth is that most of these servers had gone pretty public, many under the branding of Club Penguin. However, some resembled the original less than others, and that's where we're going next. Now, I'm no expert when it comes to dealing with assets and that kind of jazz, but what I do know is that for many games, you would typically find ways to switch up with the power of mods. Mods, short for modifications, are typically alterations implemented by players which change aspects of the game, typically with the intent of enhancing a game's entertainment value and providing a little more variety. Mods play a significant role in many online communities, particularly for people who find the regular game a little too vanilla. Even if it's Club Penguin. Some people just want a modded game where they can feel like they're playing God. On principle, I don't have a problem with that. Modded games are fairly standard and unexceptional. However, what if a modded server decided that they wanted to compete with the mainstream servers and present itself as a viable market alternative to the original Club Penguin? Okay, a bit chaotic. How about that modded server decide to partake in various underhanded tactics to advance their status and their profit within the community? Wait, what? Yeah. Let's talk about Virtual Penguin.
Shut down, so... yeah, it's hit a lot of people. We're going to be checking a private server called Virtual Penguin. You may have seen this from my 5th YouTube anniversary video of people advertising this. Well, I didn't even know what it was back then. I thought it was like some type of hacking thing to let you have a membership. But then I looked it up on YouTube and it's actually a private server. So this is actually really cool.
Virtual Penguin was a modded server, once again established before Club Penguin's demise. However, with the news that Club Penguin was closing its doors, the lads over at Virtual Penguin saw an opportunity to set up a bot to advertise their server with the hope of attracting users in search of another option. They probably garnered a fare through patrons through this method, however it was not enough, and with other servers pulling a user base, they decided they wanted to up the ante a little. What did this entail?
In the post titled, "Warning, don't use use Virtual Penguin. They mentioned that the team behind Virtual Penguin was hacking other Club Penguin private servers and banning everyone on them. This was most likely in order to block people out of their accounts in the other private servers so that they'd sign up to Virtual Penguin instead as an alternative. Here's a screenshot of Anthony, who I'm pretty sure is the person in charge of Virtual Penguin, rallying up his team in the DMs and announcing that they're going to kill Super CPPS, another private server. So these guys weren't just trying to innocently grow and promote their website, they were trying to monopolize the game by killing off the competition. What do you mean you chill with them? Wasn't your philosophy more users equals more money? We must eradicate Super CPPS. Then one of his minions pipes up, I want to take down CPR. That's Club Penguin Rewritten, which pretty much was and still is the biggest Club Penguin private server out there. Anthony responds, we can't, not yet anyway. And Timmy's like, why? And to that, Anthony responds, why not build our empire? I'd like to remind you that he's talking about a Club Penguin private server. Why not build our empire by conquering the weaker CPPSs first? You say you're able to take down Super CPPS, so let's f*** their sh** up. Wow, I feel like I'm reading Game of Thrones.
Yes, in a video by gaming YouTuber Tamago, he documents how a moderator by the name of Anthony was targeting competing services with the intent to jeopardize their business while offering a much more stable, useful service himself. It was a rather maniacal maneuver, but some may find it a bit drastic given that it's, well, Club Penguin. It doesn't stop there though. Following Tamago's reporting on the situation, Anthony ordered the hacking of Tamago's Snapchat before sending explicit content to his contacts and joining Tamago's Discord server to brag about it. A rather bizarre situation. And yet, it doesn't even end there. It's only the start.
I can't log in. I go check my email. Three emails in a row from Team Snapchat. First one says there was a login attempt from an iPhone X. I do not have an iPhone X. Second one says my password was changed. By who? Third one says the login authentication app was enabled. So at this point, I'm like, okay, I have been pwned. Yeah, that's weird. I didn't send anything. What did it say? He's like, well, yeah, so the message said, f*** all you
gentlemen.
Dick pic. So there were three supposed people involved in the incident. One of them, called Jacko, posted a couple of screenshots to show that they were indeed logged into my Snapchat account. While another one, the one who claimed to be Anthony, although his name on Discord was Riley, wrote that he had created evidence of me asking fans for explicit images and that he had sent this evidence to Keemstar. Now, Aaron, another moderator on my Discord server, asked them why they hacked my account, and Riley, who again is supposedly the real Anthony, posted my video talking about Club Penguin private servers. So this was apparently a revenge hacking, which I don't think was justified, because in that video, I wasn't even making fun of anybody. I was more so just laughing at the fact that there was drama in the Club Penguin community to begin with.
In Tamago's first video on this matter, he states that as recording, Virtual Penguin was defunct. However, they had merely rebranded and adopted a more mainstream Club Penguin approach. Anthony, or as other people know him as, Riley, was still very much active within the community, this time on the craftily named Club Penguin Online. Now, Club Penguin Online was once again a place with fewer constraints, and with the new lockdown measures forcing many people to spend more time inside, a lot of individuals, including those of the younger generation, decided to spend more time with online games. This led to media outlets and YouTubers flocking to farm the new epic headline of Club Penguin being back, with differing degrees of accuracy.
This Evening Standard article claims that the game was relaunched by Penguin Club's creators. They called it Penguin Club, which suggests to me that these articles were written hastily as a way to gather views and clicks, rather than as the result of any genuine journalistic motivation.
This caused a surge in Club Penguin Online's traffic, as many people were probably looking at how to play Club Penguin Online, and that led them to Club Penguin Online. There is the trickery. and by April 2020, Club Penguin Online was the most actively used Club Penguin, with over 7 million members. However, Club Penguin Online was no Club Penguin, and with a more laissez-faire approach to what it deemed as suitable content, it inevitably led to a bit of a shock for children who signed up under the impression that this was similar to the original. In a rather ironically amusing yet unnerving article by the BBC, they chronicle some of the interactions that a BBC reporter had on the site. Some of the examples illuminated the BBC's boomeristic nature, but others did raise legitimate concern and probably shouldn't be anywhere near content with the Club Penguin name attached to it.
There's tons of swearing, and almost all conversations end up about sex. There's even penguin e-sex, basically sexting. There's also some pretty toxic chat and bullying. I saw some horrible anti-Semitism and racism. At one stage, I was invited to someone's igloo, which had been decorated by spelling out the N-word in chairs.
Now, as I understand, there were certain boundaries between the mature sections and the more universal areas. However, these borders were not enforced, and although it's impossible to stop younger children from playing more mature games, maybe publicly marketing a mature version of a children's game and making it fully accessible alongside the moderated version is a bad idea, particularly considering the target demographic. It is antithetical to the reason that the game was made in the first place. You're kind of letting that greasy old man play with the kids in the jungle gym. It's a bit suspect, and I'm not trying to imply anything here about its creator, but... Yes, it appears our friend Riley was up to a little more than hacking people's Snapchats. Now, he had been reported for this all the way back in 2018 with corroborating evidence. However, these posts hadn't stopped him at the time, and they had continued to behave in rather reprehensible fashion. It appeared that as the owner of Club Penguin Online and the individual with control over the staff in the game, he was surrounded and enabled by people who were more concerned about personal status than the safety of their users. Nonetheless, one thing that the existing allegations highlighted were that Riley's actions were reckless and done with the brazen attitude of someone who thought he could get away with everything. And for a while, he did. However, eventually someone's gonna realize the futility of power in the world of Club Penguin and turn on you with actual consequences. And in 2020, with the spike of interest in Club Penguin Online, one former member decided that he'd had enough.
Today I'm making this video because I want the world to know what Club Penguin Online is doing, what the owner of that game is doing, and the evil, the sickening, the disgust that community has and that is hiding from you, the user.
With this video came a domino effect which would bring about the apocalypse for online Club Penguin content. Joey Hughes was a former moderator for Club Penguin Online, where he was known as Twix and a few other pseudonyms to boot. He claims to have left when he had enough of the system that Club Penguin Online and its owner were operating. However, upon his departure in October 2019, screenshots show the CPO team had attempted to smear Twix's reputation, implying that he had been sacked for inappropriate behavior. He had defended himself in a Reddit thread at the time, but it appears that come 2020, he was no longer comfortable with the authority of this website and sought to take it down. Over the space of three videos, he shows evidence and provides in-depth testimony which not merely paints Riley as being a malicious hacker and all-round megalomaniac, but also as a predator and someone who used his power to bargain for various explicit content from people who were not of age, and then proceeding to brag about it. On top of this, he talks about the support system in place and the corrupted colleagues that Riley surrounds himself with for the pursuit of that sweet, sweet Club Penguin moolah.
Club Penguin Online is the biggest server out there. There is no server that has as many active users, as many registered users as Club Penguin Online, and it's very scary knowing that someone like Riley, someone that is as sick-minded and evil as Riley, owns this server.
It's hard to think of much to say about this situation, really. It was basically a Club Penguin mafia. People were being doxxed, harassed, hacked, sites were being DDoSed, all of which created a cycle. When Club Penguin Online gathered traction, more people wanted to be a part of the action. This led people reaching out to Riley for roles on the servers, which would allow Riley to solicit inappropriate content in exchange for these ranks. This led to a more expansive workforce and more people to do his bidding, many of which included attacking other competing sites and owners, which inevitably led to greater momentum for their own server, bestowing Riley with even more power, allowing the sequence to continue.
The screenshots that you're seeing right now is from 16-year-old Chloe, which is one of his more recent exes, basically telling me that Riley asked Foods. She sent him and she, in return, got admin. Now, I want you guys to know that anyone under the age of 18 in both the United Kingdom and in America is considered a minor. Chloe is 16. Riley is 20 years old.
And what if you wanted out? Well, it turns out that sending explicit content to a person not known for his integrity probably wasn't the best idea. And even if you didn't, it appears that you were not safe.
But the only reason why I stayed silent was because Riley had my personal information. He had my address, he had my phone number, he had photos of me. So he had information on me, and he threatened me that if I spoke out against him, if I told anyone what was going on, that he would swat me and he would make my life hell.
Riley had control in the places that mattered, and in the world of Club Penguin, behaved like a kingpin. And what is a pimp without the ladies?
Back for you. If you send to Riley, he will give you admin in return. That's what happened with Chloe. That's what happened with Vale. That's what happened with Sydney. That's what happened with tons of other staff members that just kind of randomly popped out of nowhere and no one knows where the hell they came from. Riley is also a big, big advocate on e-dating. Riley loves to date young girls online. He e-dates minors. He e-dated Vale, who is a minor. He e-dated Sydney, who's a minor. Chloe, who's a minor. And currently this girl named Miriam, who just recently they got a Club Penguin wedding. So congratulations, guys, on your underage wedding. I'm happy for you guys.
You'll have to forgive me for feeling a little nauseous. But regardless, given the server's success, it generated a serious amount of income, allowing Riley to take his predatory tendencies to the next level, allegedly visiting some of his e-girls. From former colleagues to rival websites, Riley directed a trail of destruction despite actually having no discernible hacking or coding skills of his own. He had the power, he had the goals, and that was all that mattered to him.
This server is a threat. We have allowed this man, this sick individual, to have this much power. The money that he's making, he is using to have people hacked. He is paying hackers to do these horrible things. You're giving this man money because the ads that run on his site, he uses.
Joey's position as a former staff member who carried out Riley's dirty work and is only now choosing to call out Club Penguin with their current prestige could be interpreted as a bit opportunistic. However, the abundance of evidence and already existent testimony before his video dating back to 2018 heavily supports his point of view, helping this content serve as an additional platform to expose Riley's behavior. The Club Penguin Online crew didn't cover themselves with glory either, regularly concealing incidents and fabricating resignations, only to allow Riley to still run the ship, a position which he had a stranglehold on. However, it seems that he was losing his grip, and with the publication of Joey's videos, this evidence began to circulate even more. And although initially not gathering too much recognition, received a signal boost when other large commentary creators began covering the story.
It's what seems to be a common theme with everyone who talks about this man is that anyone who speaks out against him gets harassed by him.
He used to threaten to dox people a lot whenever just the slightest little thing that would make him angry.
All this evidence of Riley slash Anthony doing this absolutely revolting the testimony from this girl as well, and the conversations people are having about this man, and it's all a similar theme, makes me believe that something awful has been going on in Club Penguin Online. This is a huge website with millions of kids on it. I think it absolutely should be investigated by the FBI or some sort of authority.
Club Penguin Online themselves did not seem too delighted with the coverage, but instead of attempting to respond to the claims, decided that they were just going to launch a smear campaign against their detractors. Some of this included attacking people like Twix as a doxer, though there seems to be some timeline issues with this comment in particular. This also has the incredibly convincing "I'm merely an innocent bystander" line, which is actually quite hilarious, so I thank him for that. I found another deleted post, looked at the evidence, and to be honest, it then becomes very messy, particularly with Joey's own response.
I just want everyone to know that me and Kate did date, and you know, it's a 2-year difference. At the time that I dated Kate, I was 19, she was 17, and she was going on 18. So it's a 2-year difference, 1-year difference. That's legal. And you know, she, me and her dated for a little bit, and I dated her all the way until she turned 18. And then after that, we broke up. And she did send me and I never screenshotted them. I never, you know, did what Riley did. I never blackmailed her. I never did any of that stuff. But she did send me, but she full willingly sent them to me. We were in a relationship, and she full willingly sent them to me. You know, I did collect news from her, but like I said, I never blackmailed her, I never exposed her, I never will do that. This is horrible. Revenge porn is horrible, and I will never do that.
I kind of pity the dude here because I do understand the nuances in power dynamics and blackmail. What Riley was doing was much, much, much worse, and isn't really comparable to the actions of a late adolescent couple with equal power and 2 years between them. However, if you are going to make the argument of legality, you should probably make sure that your hands are clean as well, because otherwise it brings into question the utilization of that argument for the moral purpose. However, Joey did appear to disprove the notion that he had forcefully obtained any content and continued to expose their shady behavior in falsifying claims. Joey also later received an apology from the guy who uploaded the original post on Reddit, which probably explains why it was deleted. However, I did manage to unearth their formal response. It was terrible. The only thing of interest was a link to a page which was alleged to be the truth page, but unfortunately that has been lost to the sands of time, though I assume it wouldn't diverge too much from the narrative that we'd seen elsewhere.
Claims that people are constantly jealous of them and are just trying to bring them down, and that jealousy is the main motivator because of how successful their server is. They also say that the screenshots have been debunked and were blurry Photoshop pictures that have been proved time and time again to be false. And also they claim that this Dominic guy who's exposing them has gone around Discord using Riley's name on a fake account and making up these screenshots. But then we have the chat logs from Club Penguin, Skype conversations, the Discord between the two people that didn't even involve Dominic 2 years ago talking about Riley's behavior, staff calling Riley out on his behavior. There's a lot more evidence that matches up with the story Dominic is telling us.
There are a couple videos about this, but most of their statements just seem like a desperate attempt by Riley and his team to save the floundering reputation of the website. Oh, and one more fun fact, a post reflecting on this was posted to the drama subreddit, and it was removed by the moderators for causing too much drama. Nice. This is Club Penguin, remember? Yet, in spite of all this absurdity, this was really a detour for only the most engaged in the drama. Because truth be told, there was no volume of smear campaigns which could really overturn the weight of the evidence. Only direct counter-evidence could do that, and no one seemed to have any. Eventually, Riley's page was removed altogether from the Club Penguin online wiki as if he had never existed, and they attempted to start anew. However, it was a little too late for that. You see, since the exposure of these claims and the accompanying evidence, multiple people had been beseeching Disney to take action. After all, this affair had been operating under their name, and for some people who may not be able to distinguish Club Penguin and their relative clones, they may begin to blame Disney for letting this happen, subsequently affecting their revenue flow, and Disney wouldn't want that. So on the 15th of May, with the evidence amounting, Disney decided to take action, issuing DMCAs to Club Penguin servers, including Club Penguin Online and Club Penguin Rewritten. Around the same time, an individual involved with Club Penguin Online was also arrested, assumed to be Riley. He was subsequently released on bail pending further charges. At the time, many people chose to celebrate, particularly those who had just been acquainted with this rather sinister situation. And they had reason to. A dangerous individual had been stopped, and many people perhaps saved and liberated in the process. However, for many, this outcome was equally bittersweet, as it marked the end of an era. Where do we go from here?
Club Penguin is not back, and Club Penguin is not coming back.
When Disney came, they didn't just come for the offending parties, they handed out DMCAs without discrimination towards both Online and Rewritten, causing many other sites to panic as well. This was done under the veil of protecting the children, but if they genuinely cared, they would have done it long before May 2020. In a way, I do wonder why they waited so long. Maybe they do intend to bring Club Penguin back at some point and thought the private servers would help maintain user interest. After all, they have held on to the rights to the game, so maybe they plan on letting EA develop the next Club Penguin game. Whatever their intent for keeping the game alive was, this situation put them in a position where it would be more beneficial to shut them down. Rather selfish intentions aside, was this the right thing to do? Yes, I suppose. The problem was that these clones needed to be more professional given the users that they were dealing with, and it seemed that they just couldn't handle that responsibility properly. It's a lot of data, it's very vulnerable, and for many young gamers who weren't aware of the technicalities, if they had logins stored on a poorly protected site, it could easily expose them to individuals who had the intent of breaching the security for less than benign objectives. Kids just see Club Penguin and want a game. Eventually, some legitimately bad actors emerged, who shouldn't have been anywhere near people's data, especially children's data, and managed to create a successful business model capitalizing on people's nostalgia while exploiting the power they had acquired from it.
But there's a newer command now in the game, and it's called exclamation point gas. And if you execute this command, I'm going to put a screenshot on the screen right now. This command will give you the IP address and the register email of that user. And that is very, very scary because you have staff members like Epic, staff members like Riley who run this game. And, you know, they have a history of doxing people, DDoSing people, threatening people with personal information. And it always makes you wonder, how did they get this information? But if you have commands like this that are available to staff members, it's very easy for them to, you know, run that command, get your IP address, look in a few databases and figure out who you are, or do an email dox and get your information just from your email. And it's very scary knowing that there's children that play this game, you know, that all they have to do is just run a command on the username and the last IP that you logged in with on the game or you registered with and the email that you registered with is all in their hands, just by a single command.
It was easy for press investigations to pick apart the flimsy barriers between children's and mature content, and with a director who behaved like a mob boss while indulging in some pretty cretinous depravity himself, it was only a matter of time until this behavior was brought to light. It's just a shame it wasn't sooner. With that said, I still feel bad there isn't some sort of compromise. If Disney let these sites exist for years, then what would have stopped them from allowing a verified fan-run Club Penguin domain to run under their general supervision? However, Disney doesn't seem like one for compromises. It's all or nothing for them often. And in this instance, as much as I don't like them, the decision was probably right. Disney may well have additional plans for the game in the future because it seems they never went out of their way to antagonize their audience. But when the time seemed right, they decided they had more to lose by not taking action. Smaller private servers will probably continue to exist and maybe some new platforms will arise once more. But with the current precedent set, their long-term survival can hardly be guaranteed. It's a shame, but good things seldom last forever. Upon writing, Club Penguin Rewritten site is still accessible, but apparently a large majority of the staff have since quit, with other allegations from a mystery account surrounding their conduct too. Though it looks like they are intending to continue operations, it's hard to provide an enthusiastic endorsement. Maybe they've decided to call Disney's bluff, and I wish them luck on that front. As for Club Penguin Online, well, their domain is down with a rather obstinate message in its place, claiming the YouTubers who reported on the situation were paid off. Charming. Club Penguin has always thrived on the sentiment of community, and with many of these servers, I feel that was people's intent. They wanted to hold on to something that they didn't feel they deserved to lose. When Disney shut down the original site in rather ruthless fashion, people weren't ready to move on, and certainly not with what Disney offered in its place. There was always discussion of a successor for the original Club Penguin, given the accumulating bugs and complications, but the successor needed to feel like Club Penguin, and Club Penguin Island just didn't. Runescape, for example, in spite of their new releases, generally keeps the map true to the original and has maintained a separate server called Old School Runescape, and it's commonly reported that the Old School server performs better than the new one. You need to be sensitive to your audience's loyalty to a particular formula. Disney underestimated people's ability to hold on to what they had become accustomed to and what they would do to maintain that. The new sites were a defiant response to the closure of the original Club Penguin, and at first they did serve as a way for the community members to hold on to what they enjoyed. A tight-knit community focused on their love of the game can typically self-govern quite well, but as the months and years elapsed, it grew into its own market, and when you have a market with real money involved, you may not attract people with the community's interests at heart. That's why we have checks and balances, particularly when younger and more vulnerable users are involved. Unfortunately, some individuals were not accountable to the degree that many would deem acceptable, and this exploitation of power spiraled out of control, creating a cycle and subsequent chain reaction of events leading us to where we are today. Club Penguin would never go quietly, but sometimes we should worry less about letting go and more about who may grab a hold.
And therefore, no matter how well-intentioned the owner of a private server may be, they cannot be trusted to safeguard your personal information. Keep in mind that whenever you sign up to these websites, you don't only give them your email address and your password, but you also give them access to your IP address. And with your IP address, you can be located. So before you sign up to these websites, you've got to ask yourself, do I trust these people with my information?
We spent a lot of time looking back at all these problems, and for a moment, at least at the end, I think it's fair we look forward. In 2018, when the remaining Club Penguin staff at the Kelowna office were dismissed, with the detached letter from the faceless Disney Corp, a certain man reached out to them, Lane Merrifield, one of the original creators of Club Penguin. He shared a message of solidarity and offered these soon-to-be redundant workers a drink at their local bar to talk it over. The moral was plain though. It can be hard to let go of what you've come to know. But when one door closes, another will open. The sun will come up, the seasons will change, and there'll be something to move on to, even if it doesn't seem like it at the time. For example, one of Lane's co-founders, Lance Preeb, has since been working on a new game, Box Critters. I haven't played it myself, but it appears to be what I would brand as a true spiritual successor. It feels as if it was being made with the ethos that the original Club Penguin offered. There are a lot of stylistic similarities as well. If Club Penguin Island was Rollercoaster Tycoon World, Box Critters is Planet Coaster, gamer reference. So if you feel disaffected from the community due to the recent drama yet still want to be a part of something in the same vein, maybe you'll find something there. If not, that's okay too. Maybe the original is irreplaceable to you. Maybe you just need a break. I know I do. The point remains, as long as people like Lance and Lane are still around, the spirit of Club Penguin will endure, in whatever form it takes, and even though its current state may be disappointing, there's always something to take forward, and I think people will find that. All this time spent trying to recreate what Club Penguin was, when in actuality, the real Club Penguin was inside us all along. But that version isn't playable, so who cares? When did Club Penguin die? Some will say 2017, some will say 2018, some will say 2020. Some will say that it's still alive, but its legacy is a complex one which has only seemed to evolve over time, for better and for worse, making people wonder, when should one truly waddle on? So yes, that was the video. Do not have a clue when this one's going to be released. Jesus Christ. What is going on in the world? I have lost my mind. But we are persevering, and I will continue to persevere. Sometimes, that's all we can do. I want to give a big thanks to my editors once again. They've done a great job. Go and check them out. Send them some love. I don't know what I'd do without them. I also want to give a big thanks to my patrons at the time of recording. There's some $10 patrons up on the board right now. I also have to give a big thanks to the $50 patrons, Amanda, Caroline, Devon, Hypercube, Some Hullabaloo, and that's it. I also want to give big thanks to my $100 patrons, Brandon Junk, Christopher Carras, Yesenia Ramirez, and Candy Skulls. Thank you very much, guys. Your support is much appreciated. It makes a great difference. I don't really have too much else to add. I'll probably be heading out now because I've finally cracked. Oh, if you want to follow me on social media, they'll be in the pinned comment below too. So yeah, that's about it though. I'm probably going to leave now. So, I'm The Right Opinion, and I will see you guys in the next one.
Okay, I'll go. Troy, where's the door handle? Wait, what are you wearing? Oh no.